My soul finds rest in God alone, my rock and my salvation, a fortress strong against my foes, and I will not be shaken. Though lips may bless and hearts may curse, and lies like arrows pierce me, I'll fix my heart on righteousness, I'll look to Him.
Crushed our curse of death, and I am. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles, turn to Psalm chapter number 12. Psalm chapter number 12. And the psalmist is going to ask the question, where have all the godly gone? I thought about that and it reminded me, because the psalmist, he's grieving, he has pain. He looks around at his society and he says, where have all the godly gone? Made me think about the humorous story, I guess. Maybe it's as true as it is humorous. I heard a while back, it said, what's the difference between a used car salesman and a computer salesman? And had to think about that a moment. What would be the difference between a used car salesman and a computer salesman? And they said, a used car salesman knows when he's lying to you. And it's funny in a sense, but when we go to the used car salesman, we expect them to lie to us. And you talk to a computer person and you don't really think that they know what they're talking about, right? Yeah, they're just going to tell you what you want to hear so that you'll buy. And here is a psalm. Really, the psalmist, it's a statement of sorrow and of grief and of pain. Where have all the godly gone? Sorrow, boy, you've had it in your life. You've had grief. It's unyielding. It's unpredictable, isn't it? You don't know where it's going to take you, sorrow and grief. It creates many times us uncomfortable in our life. It's unnerving. Sorrow, I wrote, is not tame. And that's true. But just as much as it's not tame, sorrow and pain and grief, they're inevitable. No matter who you are and what time you live in, thousands of years ago, the psalmist writes this, but it's true today, we will have sorrow and grief and pain. You may feel it as a death of a loved one. You may feel it from the betrayal of a friend. You may know the injustice in a situation, or maybe a pain in being persecuted at work. Pain in life is guaranteed. It is common to all of us. Job says, man born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. It's common, but it's not easy. Psalm chapter number 12 expresses sorrow, but not individually. It's a group of people and how life in general has changed and what culture is. And so he says, where have all the godly gone? Now, this is a psalm of lament, a psalm of sorrow. And I said there were seven different types of psalms that we would be looking at this summer. And this is a psalm of sorrow. And the psalms of sorrow or lament are important. Maybe the most important of all the psalms. And you would say, well, why would that be, Pastor? Let me give you a couple reasons. Number one, a psalm of lament, that's the largest group of all the psalms that are written. Number two, they express our deep emotion. And it's an emotion that each and every one of us are going to feel. The psalms of sorrow or lament are so important. They deal honestly with our feelings. And feelings that we're uncomfortable many times to share with others. We're uncomfortable to acknowledge or deal with ourselves. That's a psalm of lament. Makes us look at it. A psalm of lament is a model that deals with grief, but God-centered. How should grief look? This is a psalm, it tells us. And I believe this may be most important. It helps us rediscover a path of worship through sorrow. When you have a time of pain, of sorrow, and of grief, some just pull back into themselves. Some look at life in a different manner. And this makes us stop and reevaluate how we are worshiping God. A psalm of lament is so important. You say, Pastor, why would you bring this up? Because it is important. It's common. It's not easy. but it is applicable to each and every one of us here this morning. I believe it's going to be helpful as we read through Psalm chapter number 12. It'll be comforting to some, instructive to others. It's so important. There are three words this morning as we look at this psalm that I want you to understand. They capture the essence of Psalm chapter number 12. Psalm chapter number 12 is not a large psalm, but these three words capture what Psalm 12 is all about. The first word is cry, the second word is promise, and the third word is trust. Let's look at that first word, and that first word is cry. Cry is a longing for help. The psalmist is going to waste no time in asking for help. As we read these verses, you're going to see a person that is overwhelmed, a person that is frustrated. He is scared by everything he sees in his culture and in his society, and he cries out for help. Psalm chapter number 12, let's read verses 1 and 2. It says, "Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. They speak vanity, every one with his neighbor, with flattering lips, and with a double heart do they speak." He says, help. We could write it down. He says, save us. That's what he's crying out. The Hebrew word is yasa. Its word or derivative of this word is used 350 times throughout the Old Testament. It simply means to move a person from distress to safety, giving them deliverance. That's what he's asked. Save us. Get me out of this terrible place and put me in a safe place. I need some safety. And we all live like that. We don't want to live. When we talk about our children, and it is good to have them here so that we can see them, I want you to pray for them and remember, yes, we have church in here and we worship the Lord and we study the scriptures, but it happens throughout our campus, and what we do together is important for us here, but it's important for generations to come for us to remain faithful. And you look at that and you look at our society and you say, help, Lord, like the psalmist here is going to say. There's a strong spiritual connotation to this, isn't there? It's the storyline of the Bible. We see it all the way through. God delivers or he saves his people. We see it. It's a thread throughout the whole Bible. The New Testament. Jesus' name even represents this. Matthew chapter number 1. Verses 21, Jesus' name is tied to his mission. Did you know that? And she, that's Mary, shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Here's what it means. For he shall save his people from their sins. Sometimes we call him Savior. The Old Testament, save us, Lord. Jesus came to save his people from their sins. It's hard to overestimate this idea of a Savior. Lord, save us. The theme throughout the Bible. In the Old Testament, over and over again, what does God do? He saves his people. Oh, sometimes they weren't following him and they were doing things wrong, yet he comes and delivers them anyways. Psalm chapter 106 is entirely dedicated to tracing the mercy of God and him saving them. Let me just read two of those verses. Psalm 106, verse 7. Our fathers understood not thy wonders in Egypt. They remembered not the multitudes of thy mercy, but provoked him at the sea, even at the Red Sea. Verse 8, nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power to be known. God saved them. At the Red Sea, he saved them. But what were they doing at the Red Sea? They were not calling on God to save them. They were not worshiping the Lord. They were complaining and they were griping and they were not edifying. They were bringing everybody down and says, Moses, you led us in the wilderness just to kill us. God, you don't care about us. Yeah, I know you just did this marvelous thing just hours, days before as we left Egypt. But God, you brought us out here to kill us. And what did God do? He saved them. That's what it says in Psalm number 106, and that's what it's full of. God delivers his people. Why? It says in that verse, that he might make his mighty power to be known. He saves us so when others look around and go, wow, never expected that. They couldn't have done that. Wonder how that happened. God did it. When you cry out and things aren't going right and you look at society and you want to cry against the darkness and scream against all the darkness, that's not what we're to do. Yes, I know our culture is bad. I know these things. We're not to scream against the darkness. We're to cry out and say, God, save us. And in your mighty power, you save us and you'll get great glory in it. You are the God of salvation. You are Jehovah. The psalmist is saying, God, what you do is save people. That's who you are, and that's what you do. Save us right now. Help. The psalmist calls to God to save us. But he invites another question here. Help or save us. Save us from what? Save us from what? Well, the psalmist here we read is grieved about everything he sees. He sees a culture that's lost its way, and he's seen religious people that have lost their influence. The righteous have no influence on the culture around them, and he's grieved. And so his statements say, the godly, they're gone, in verse number one. In verse number one, he says, the faithful ones, they vanished from amongst the people. They're just not there. Verse number two, everyone that utters to his name, everybody that's talking, all they do is say lies. And then he goes on, with flattering lips and a double heart, they speak. That's what's going on in our society, just people walking around lying. The righteous are not flourishing. The unrighteous, the sinners, seem to be winning the day. And his heart is grieved, and he feels the pain. He lives in a culture that's lying. And in a culture where lying is commonplace. If that's the best thing for the situation, then lying is okay if it's okay for the situation. And he's grieved by this. And then there's double talk. That means someone smiles and says something to you, but they don't mean it. They have a double heart. They're lying to you, but you don't really know it. That is discouraging. That's disheartening. Yes, to know that evil's all around us, but then to have someone befriend you and be kind to you, only they were doing it for their own benefit. They weren't doing it. They were lying to you and deceiving you. I grew up watching Disney, and maybe you did too, and now there's Pixar and all these animations. One of the newer ones is that Toy Story. There's Buzz Lightyear, to infinity and beyond, and it was Woody, and their boy was Andy, and boy, that was a great... And then there's two, and there's three. In the third movie, there's a character, and he is a teddy bear. And a teddy bear ought to be loving and kind, but the truth is, on the outside, he says things with a very soft voice, and he's a teddy bear. But he is the leader of the evil toys. That's what he is. And so Woody and Buzz, they believe what he has to say, but he's lying to them. And in fact, his name, if you remember it, is Lots O'Huggins Bear. Lots O'Huggins Bear. Everything says he's going to be telling the truth, but he's lying. He's not only lying, he's sneaky evil. That's what the psalmist is saying. There are people that on the outside look like the right thing, that say the right thing, but they are sneaky evil. And I can't stand it in my society living like this. He's deeply concerned. The godless are gone. No one's faithful. There's lies and two-faced people everywhere. Our entire culture, even in Israel, even in the religious people, even in church, people are lying and are two-faced. I am grieved. I don't know what to turn to. And you don't have to look very far to know that the scriptures are maybe speaking, the psalmist is speaking about his day, but it's our day. It's our day. You look around and you cannot help but be grieved in a country that was founded on God, that has really known something that no other country outside of Israel has ever known, that tried to follow after God, now has gone and turned their back so far on God that we not only promote evil, not only then do we murder unborn children, which is bad enough, but I know each one of you have seen it, heard about it, and read about it, but the mainstream media doesn't want to talk about it much, that our tax dollars go to promote Planned Parenthood, who then kills the baby in such a way that they can preserve organs and body parts so they can sell them and make money for Planned Parenthood. And as they say, for the greater good of all mankind. Now good things can happen because we kill these babies and rip their arms and legs apart. And our society is not upraged. I mean, Washington ought to be ready to be burned to the ground, but our society doesn't care that much about it. It's made a little bit. The psalmist says, I look around and I am greatly grieved. We look at our culture and we shake our head in disbelief. This is not the land that I grew up in as a child. It's completely different. You're a parent, you're a grandparent, and you say, I wonder what America is going to be like for my children and my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren. I don't know. And you're grieved. For some of you, it's even personal. You've been the victim of evil in this world. You've been lied to. You've been tricked and deceived. And you feel that pain, not only in a large sense, but personally. And it resonates with you. And so the psalmist says, after all of this, he says, God, bring us justice, give us vindication, deliver us, cut these evil people off. Central to our pain is that it seems like they're getting by with it, isn't it? That's what the psalmist is going to say. Yes, it's bad that all these things are happening, but the evil people are winning and the righteous people are losing. Verse number 3, the Lord shall cut off all flattering lips, and the tongue that speaketh proud things. Who have said with our tongues, we will prevail, our lips are our own. Who is the Lord over us? Psalmist sees arrogant, arrogant people. Who is the Lord over us? And he longs for God to bring justice. Now, when you read this, it says, the Lord shall cut off all flattering lips. He's not asking God to cut their lips off and people to be walking around with no lips. Don't misunderstand that. He wants justice. He wants God to do what's right. Bring justice. Bring divine judgment. Here's a cry for God to do something. You ever feel like that? God, can you just do something? Man, they've cheated me. They've done me wrong. God, can't you do something? I've been done wrong. I've been lied to. These people are two-faced. God, can't you do something? It begins. It's a song of lament. He has pain. He has grief for all that's going on, both personally and in his culture. On this basis of his lament leads him to our second word. It's in verse number 5. It's the focal point of the entire psalm. It represents the voice of God. And it's the second word is a promise. A promise. God's answer in crisis. God always answers. When you pray and you cry out, God answers. Sometimes he tells you no. Sometimes he says, not now, and it may be immediate, but God always answers if you're his child. And here we get to see his answer in Psalm chapter number 12, verse number 5. For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy, Now will I arise, saith the Lord. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him. We get to see God saying something, and there are two promises. I told you the word is promise here, and it's a central part. When you grieve and you cry out to God, save us, then it should drive you to the promises of God. There are two promises here. Number one, God knows what's going on, and he is not standing by. For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy, now will I arise, saith the Lord. So do you understand that? God knows what's going on, and he is not standing by. He's not going to. He can't. And other psalms communicate this over and over again. Psalm 22, verse 24. God is not standing by, for he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him. But when he cried unto him, he heard. God listens. In Psalm chapter number 69, verse 33, for the Lord heareth the poor and despiseth not his prisoners. So in other words, God hears, God knows, and God really cares. Cry out to God, God save us. But it drives us to the promise, God hears, God knows, and God cares. Secondly, there's another promise here. Verse number 5. God will place him in safety. God's going to make this right. God is going to make this right. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him. When I thought about that word puffeth, it brought me to a picture. Well, I think each one of you can get this picture with me. As a little child, it was a story that was taught to me by my mom and dad, my grandmother. The story of the three little pigs. Remember they puffed, or there was a bad guy that huffed and puffed. You know, the three little pigs, they leave, and they're going to go set their life in order. They're going to do their own thing, and first little pig sets up his life, and he builds a house out of straw, but the bad wolf, the evil wolf, puffs and he blows the house down. So the pig runs to his brother's house, and there his brother's made a house out of wood, and the evil wolf puffs and blows that house down. But the two of them run to the third pig, and he has built a house out of bricks. And there they find safety. You can huff and you can puff all you want to, but the evil wolf doesn't get them. And here it is. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him. Yeah, there may be an evil wolf that's trying to get you, and society, and Satan is trying to do these things. Yes, but God says there is safety. He's hurting because he feels like evil is all around him and that evil is winning. And he longs for divine intervention. In the middle of this, God speaks. Isn't that good? God speaks. He says, I'm going to make everything right. We could spend more time on Psalm chapter number 12, and we're just not going to be able to do it this morning. Psalm chapter 12 is also a prophetic psalm. How that God is going to make everything right. And we see it here in the scriptures. In the midst of a crisis, God hears, and a promise is issued. And it's a promise you can claim today. We see it throughout the Old Testament. Let me tell you, you can see the promise in the New Testament. We have a sure promise of God that's found in the person of Jesus Christ in his word. We could go to the book of Hebrews, and if you want to write this down, you can just make a few notes. It's not going to be on the screen. God has definitely spoken to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter number 1. And in his Son, he sympathizes with us in our weakness. We see that in Psalm 1 and then again in Hebrews chapter number 1 and then again in Hebrews chapter number 4. And then he says, because of his Son, we can come boldly to the throne of grace. There we receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. That's what the psalmist is saying. You can go to God directly and have mercy and find grace in time of need. Hebrews chapter number 4, verse 16 says then that we have a sure word. All these things are true. We have a sure word. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrows, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. You have the word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. That's what we're talking about. In all of this, we can live a godly life. Hebrews chapter number 12. We can run the race that's set before us. He says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher, the creator and the perfecter of our faith. You can do it. You have a promise. Yes, this is a psalm of lament, but God stands up and says, I will give you safety. And that theme is throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament. We have this. We could say we have an oracle. That's this. That oracle means a revelation. You have a true revelation in your hands. The very word of God. It gives the answers to your needs and problems in the midst of crisis. It's loaded with promise after promise after promise after promise. When you have godly sorrow, where does it lead you? It leads you to the promises of God. Let me give you a warning. Sorrow that is not godly sorrow leads you somewhere besides the promises of God. It leads you to bitterness. It leads you to resentment. It leads you to just bringing selfishness and sadness to yourself and depression. So let me say, be sad sometimes. You can grieve over the society, be in pain over what's going on, but take your pain somewhere. And where does the scripture say? Take your sadness, your outrage, and your pain to the promise of God. God answers in the midst of our crisis. That's what He wants us to do. Don't take your pain to yourself or to someone else. They can't answer it. Sometimes I see it on Facebook. People will bring their pain and their suffering. And there's nothing wrong. Sometimes I'll see another Christian and they'll say, I'm praying for you. That's a good response. Many times I'll see a response, just keep working, you'll get through it. Better days are coming. Maybe better days aren't coming. You know what? We have those in our church that have had cancer, and God heals them, and they are cancer-free. Amen? Amen. And then we have had those that have cancer, and then they die. Amen. And to just say, oh, better days are coming, that doesn't do anything. But those that have cancer and even go to death that cling to the promises of God, why, it changes everything about them. Their life is different. When you have pain and sorrow and grief in your life, when it's godly, it takes you to the promises of God. Well, God's answer in the midst of crisis gives us a promise. There's a third word I want us to look at. First word is cry. Lord, save us. Number two, the promises. The third one is trust. Believing while hurting. Final is all about trusting God. The difference between good and godly sorrow and unhelpful and sinful grief. What is it? Because I want one, but I don't want the other. It comes down to doing more than just looking at my circumstances, my situation, my pain. It's directly related to how I trust a promise, and then I trust in those promises. Boy, it's hard. Yes, I know the promises, but it can be another step to trust those promises. It may be a big step sometimes for us, but it comes to trust. The psalmist puts it responding to the word of God. Trust is just responding to those promises. In verses 6, immediately following what he said, that he would do something. then he's got to trust. He is giving an affirmation. This is his trust to verse number 5. Upon the wicked he shall rain snares, fire and brimstone, and horrible tempest. This shall be the portion of their cup. Does it happen that day? No, it didn't happen that day. It is prophetic in some of this, but it is going to happen. And so he trusts in God. What contrast to the world the psalmist is living. He lives in a culture that is filled with lies and half-truths. And yet he says, my trust, my motive is in the Word of God, and it is sure. I read verse 6. I want to read verse number 5. The Lord trieth the righteous, but the wicked and him that loveth violence, his soul hateth. And I know that. I know what God says. I'm in chapter number 11. I'm sitting here going, that doesn't sound right. How about let's go to 6 and let's read it right. All right. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in the furnace of earth, purified 7 times. Here is his confidence. It's his confidence is in God's word. Yes, things will happen, but his confidence is in the word of God. The lies that are being said all around him, what's the contrast? This is true. In our world today, you don't have to curse the darkness. You have to shine the light of God's word. That's what we're to do as Christians. On Facebook, you don't have to sit here and argue with someone about what their lifestyle is or what they would like this America to be. You don't have to argue about that. You just have to shine the light of God's word. That's what we're to do. Psalm chapter number 12, verse number 7. This word is life-giving. It's reliable. It's trustworthy. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. God's word can be trusted. I ask the question, wonder what it's going to be like for my children, my grandchildren, your children, your grandchildren. And sometimes it gives us pain and it looks scary. He says, you know what? You can trust somebody. God is the one you can trust. You will keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. God's word can be trusted. Verse number 8, the wicked walk on every side when the vilest men are exalted. He brings us back in verse number 8 to the beginning. In verse number 1 and verse number 8, he says the same thing. Why? We live in a terrible culture, a terrible time. Circumstances may not change, but God can help me. Save me, O Lord. You can do it. We live in a culture. He could never have imagined our culture today with all of our industry and our technology. He was not stupid by any means, but by the inspiration of God, he says, my time and my culture that I live in is terrible right now. And we can say, God, like the psalmist, that's what we live in today. Lord, save us. Let me close. Let me give you a summary. Let me bring it back and maybe give you the application again so you can see Psalm chapter number 12. Number 1, as he cries out for help, he says, pain and suffering are inevitable. So be ready. It's inevitable. Don't be caught by surprise when someone lies to you. Why, the benefit of Psalm 12 says, be ready. You're going to suffer. Don't get caught off guard. Here's the second thing. Godly sorrow involves being honest about the pain. Some would like to deny pain. Oh, it's not very bad, and that's fine. Others would like to ignore it. It's not there, it didn't happen, and so we put blinders on and ignore the culture around us. That's not what God says. We are honest about it. We don't deny it. It takes us to God's goodness and God's promises when we understand it. Number three, sorrow can and should lead us to these God's promises. Self-centered sorrow, what does it do? It leads us to bondage and misery. You want to be bound up in misery? Have sorrow and think about yourself. Sometimes I go and visit and someone's hurting. They've been in the hospital. They've just gotten home, or we're talking on the phone and we're talking about them and how are you doing, and I want to be a comfort. Oh, Pastor, don't worry about me. God's taking care of me. I'm, you know, trying to be on the mend. Doctor's doing that part. How are you doing today? Can we pray about something in the church? Who in our church is suffering that we can pray for? They are not looking at themselves. They're looking at others. The promises of God, they're not self-centered. There's no bondage. There's no misery. Their God-centered sorrow leads to hope and comfort. And when they pray for others, they receive comfort from God. The fourth one here, that step, we learn to trust God while we're hurting. God doesn't always change it. We may hurt, and we trust God while we're hurting. Freedom does not come from the absence of pain. I want to be free from pain. Well, it doesn't happen that way. Freedom comes when we're learning to trust God in the midst of pain. That's so important. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads this morning. This morning I spoke to Christians. You know, Christ is your Savior. In the 9 o'clock hour, Pastor Adrian says, as a Christian, we work out our salvation. We study the scriptures. We learn the promises so that we can shine a light. This morning, maybe you've been here and you've been in pain and sorrow and grief. Say, Pastor, would you just pray for me this morning? I needed this. I needed to cry. I was disgusted with our culture and just scream at my TV way too often for all that's going on. Pastor, I don't need to be that way. I don't need to be in sorrow. I need to look to the promises of God and trust in them. Pastor, will you pray for me this morning as you close our service? I'll pray for you this morning. Just lift your hand. Some of you are in sorrow and pain and grief. I'm going to pray for you this morning. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you. As you say, be honest about this. And Lord, many in our congregation raise their hand and are being honest that there's things of pain and sorrow and grief in their life. It may be this society. It may be personal to them. But Lord, may you help them cry out to you to save us. That's what you do. And then, Lord, I pray that they will seek the promises of God and search them out. And then they will take the step of trusting those promises and seeing how that there is great freedom in trusting Jesus Christ. I pray that for each and every one this morning. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to keep your heads bowed. I've got another question. Someone may be here this morning and say, Pastor, you talked about the thread through the scriptures is about being delivered. That there is a God that wants to deliver his people. In the Old Testament, he delivered them. In the New Testament, we see that deliverance come to completion in the person of Jesus Christ. He lived a perfect life. He died on the cross. He rose again, proving that he is God. And he can give deliverance, freedom from sin. Say, Pastor, I've never asked Christ to be my Savior. But I understand that. I want to ask Christ to be my personal Savior. Pastor, this morning, will you pray for me? I don't know Christ as my personal Savior, but I want to trust him as my personal Savior. Would you raise your hand this morning? I'll pray for you this morning. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, may there never be any in our congregation that would come to a service that would leave not knowing you as their personal Savior. May we make the gospel clear and plain and know that trusting you comes freedom in life. Lord, the things that look fun in this world only bring pain and ultimately death. But Jesus Christ brings life and life everlasting. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning. I'm going to ask Pastor Joel to sing. Maybe this morning there's something on your heart. You want to go to the prayer room and pray. Maybe this morning is a time that you want to pray with someone else. This is your opportunity. I'm standing right here. I'll pray with you this morning. There's something that you've just got to get taken care of. Don't put it off. Take care of it this morning. Pastor Joel, you lead us in a song.
This is my desire. Every moment I'm awake, Lord, have